this chapter this on the demand of or so many requests from the member I conceived this idea to keep the webinar on this subject because in today's era lot of members are getting the notices from various government agencies and they are required to get their statement recorded so how to face all these things I only one person name came into my mind that is the CB Sajan sir CB Sajan sir is in the practice as a chartered accountant and also doing practice of disciplinary cases handling this is the this is my privilege to introduce him briefly Sajan sir is a practicing CA and senior partner in a reputed audit firm in New Delhi he was a banker for first 7 years of his career he is also a law graduate and post graduate in commerce he is reputed counsel in disciplinary cases on CA he has delivered hundreds of lecture on ICAI platforms on accounting and audit standards and has been visiting faculty with ICAI for IFRS and AS certificate course for 27 batches during 2009 to 2013 this is our today's speaker his brief profile I also welcome all the attendee especially ji our guruji sunil damija ji mudit jain ji rameshwar dayal ji and sushil lal ji
welcome sir
with this I request Sajan sir kindly deliberate on the subject over to Sajan sir
thank you Rajesh ji for the brief and nice introduction and good evening all participants and office bearers of Usha Road study circle this topic is very novel and some have found it as very interesting also but I am told today that Rajesh ji has got a large number of participants in the program which proves that there is a lot of keenness from members to understand the intricacies about this I do not claim to be an expert on any of the matters in my life whatever small experience I have got in my life I am sharing with you all guys you know the times these days are very challenging for our profession and it has a lot to do with the current economic atmosphere of our country at least in the for the last 13 to 14 years our economy has been slowing and on the last 4-5 years a little faster than before and when the economic cycle gets disturbed commercial failures are bound to happen and when we are moving through a churning stage of digitization and electronic computer age the old generation businesses are facing music of the times more than that when we had an economic boom since 1992 onward the lure of making faster money went into many minds and a lot of investments had taken place sometimes by diverting away the working capital of good running businesses but those investments have turned bad over a period of time when the economy has become bad so there have been multiple reasons because of which the businesses started failing and when the businesses fail or where calculations go awry what happens is delinquencies defaults or failure in fulfilling the obligations happen so those are you know sometimes they are in repayment of loans sometimes failure in repayment of other debts, sometimes failure to fulfill the obligation of delivering services or goods or properties or whatever, reneging from the contracts already agreed upon, and sometimes activities by promoters to survive or pass on the times by arranging temporary funds or through inappropriate means. So knowingly or unknowingly, people have tried to survive through means that they found best at that particular point of time. However, in the eyes of law, all of them might not have been found correct or appropriate. And also, when we try passing these times, as standard accountant, we are watchdogs. We are observers. We know calculations, if they go out of control, this can lead to big financial consequences, and questions would be raised not only to the promoters or the management of the organization, but to the chartered accountants who have been associated with such entities also. So my experience taught me that we chartered accountants were very naive to the consequences of such an economic collapse. But now the things have come to such a pass, such a situation where investigating agencies are trying to find out whether the failures on the part of various organizations, be it on repayment of their debts or be it on fulfilling their obligations under the contracts, or be it on resorting to raising of finances through improper means, whether they were truly correct in accordance with the law or not. This is the context in which investigations are taking place. And we have got various agencies nowadays, the Serious Fraud Investigation Office of the under the Ministry of Corporate Affairs is a big entity which has got experts from all spectrum of the professions, legal professional, computer professionals, accounting professionals, and the experts in laws, various laws. We have got CBI involved in cases where the banks have alleged defaults in loan because the entities who borrowed money had resorted to improper means for raising money. I have to say that these allegations are sometimes not very genuine allegations. There have been genuine cases of allegations where there was a need for making allegations, but there have been cases where the failures were really commercial, but to save the face of the people on the other side, they have made allegations. So when allegations of fraud or siphoning of funds are made by stakeholders like lenders or the other financial stakeholders, investigating agencies would naturally look into it very deeply. And the difference in this process is what? We auditors do not view the financial reporting in the way an investigator does. For two reasons. One is, when we do the audit, the background is different. when the investigations happen, something must have already triggered in some financial crime must have been reported. So if a crime is already reported, then based on that crime, the investigating agencies must have collected number of evidences by meeting and questioning various people connected to the running of the entity. Now, these kind of questioning or these kind of suspicion was not there when a chartered accountant was doing the audit of that particular entity. So the background is totally different. So then when the investigators are equipped with a lot of new information that a CA did not collect when he did the audit, for him to face the question in this background of post facto, I would say, scenario is a little different. So we chartered accountants sometimes get bewildered, you know, perplexed by these kind of questions. Are ye kis tarah ka sawal hai? Investigators would ask the questions. There is no doubt about it. It is their job. We have to respond to them very responsibly. We have to cooperate with them. They have a job in hand. But we must make clear to them that, sir, I as an auditor was not having those information that you might have collected after the reported financial crime took place. So therefore, the way in which I approach the audit and the way in which you are approaching the investigation are different. So please don't judge my audit from that angle. If an organization was running normally and business activities were going on without much problems, the amount of skepticism that I would be using would not be to that level where I suspect the promoter as a fraudster. In the first place, if I believed that the management of the company had done something illegal, I would not have done this audit at all. So this kind of statements when you make, the investigators naturally lose patience because they are not there to listen to your lecture anyways. But the point is, why the investigators are taking statements from you? Why they have summoned you? They have to create their report and make charge sheet. Now, what is the process that they follow? They try to collect information from all the people on one particular subject, be it on a financial transaction or be it on a particular relationship with anybody or be it on a contractual arrangement with somebody, an investigator would like to ask same question to different people to have different perspectives. So you must remember that when an investigator raised a question to you related to an organization that is under investigation, he might have already asked this question to others also. So he is cross verifying the facts with you. Now, when they begin the investigation, they intimidate you practically. Why they are doing that? Because unless some scare and fear is made in your mind, you would not fall in line easily. So they take the reference of the Companies Act provisions where the fraud, falsification of account, giving wrong statements or evidence, all these considered as criminal offense, serial in 479, 477, 478, etc., etc. They would refer to them and they would remind you in the beginning itself, look, you are under oath and if you give a wrong evidence, you would be in problem. Then they present the case in such a way that a lot of illegal activities have happened. So you get a sense that, oh, that means this company has done something, a lot of things wrong. Then to save you, you might think of putting blame on the company or anybody. Please don't do all those things. You know, when you are trying to put blame on others, the investigators will try to capitalize on that. The moment you start taking names of other people and putting blame, please remember, the investigators would go back to those people and ask, take your name and ask these questions to them also. So they would be again putting blame back to you. So the blame game or pleading innocence, I didn't know what was happening, this all, these are not the professional approaches that are to be adopted by the professional. These are not professional approaches. We must have confidence while addressing the investigator that you have done, I have done my job with utmost sincerity. And if at all something must have happened, it could be a very negligible or unintentional error, which cannot have very serious repercussions. We don't guarantee that when we do the audits or a certification, 100% accuracy is assured. Nobody guarantees that. That is not our job. Even in our audit report, what we do is we are giving reasonable assurance, which is less than absolute assurance. So nobody is asking about absolute assurance from an auditor. When there is a financial crime, the investigators or court may question you, what kind of audit is this? Then why should there be audit? That's all. It is their job they are doing. But we have to have the patience to make them understand, sir, audit worldwide means not absolute assurance of 100% accurate. That is not humanly possible. Even within the organization, when people, so many people do the jobs, they cannot guarantee that each other one in the organization has done correctly. Why we are reasoning with the investigators on this is to give a sense to him that, sir, if you are trying to find fault with me, do that after understanding what is my job, what is my profile. My job is different. So you should have the caliber, peace of mind, and calmness to do this. Because agar aap dar gaye ya aapka confidence ekdam khatam ho gaya, aap theek se bol nahi paate, to आपकी रवैया, आपकी रेस्पॉन्स देख करके ही इन्वेस्टिगेटिंग एजेंसी को लगता है कि चलो ये भी शामिल है. सो रिमेनिंग काम, स्टेइंग काम एंड देन आंसरिंग टू क्वेश्चंस, यू नो, वेरी प्रोफेशनली इज व्हाट इज द फर्स्ट थिंग टू रिमेंबर. एंड इन द प्रोसेस यू ऑलवेज अश्योर हिमसेल्फ, आई एम हियर टू सपोर्ट यू. Just as you want to know the truth behind this matter, I also would like to show two things. One, I have not been part of any wrong. Second, I would like to give as much support as possible from my side to make your job easy. Sometimes they play another role. You become the approver. You become the witness of the government against the company. Then you would be spared. These are, you know, inappropriate tactics used by the investigators. See, if you were aware about something that was going wrong, in the first place, you would not have been party to any of those financial statements. So that is your considered position, that I never knew about anything wrong going on in the organization. When you never knew about anything going on in the organization, how can you turn to be an approver or a witness or something against the management? So these kind of ploys must be carefully weighed by the members who address the investigating agencies. I'm not here suggesting that you must lie, you must not cooperate, etc., etc. But I am talking from the basic confidence that a chartered accountant who does a job as an attester, as an auditor, as a certifying person, would not do it knowingly that he was doing something wrong. There is a possibility that he has overlooked the processes, or he has diluted the degree of collecting evidences. But that is not to say that, you know, he has compromised on his professional responsibility. So, first point is that we must not fall to the tricks of the investigating agencies to keep you as their, you know, witness or approver. Now, when the investigation process begins, as I told you in the beginning, what happens is they take your statement, and a statement is under oath. So whether it is CBI or SFAO, ED, where, you know, the matters are of money laundering and FEMA violations, it is ED. And if it is only financial crime, then it is CBI. But if it is related to a corporate, naturally SFAO would involve it. And if it is something more than that in degree, like terrorism, counterterrorism, things like that, then other agencies like NIA and all would come. So whoever is the agency will have a similar angle of asking questions. And anything and everything that you wrote in that statement, please remember, can be used against you. So you have to be very measured in your language, in your statement. Certain principles to be remembered are, please do not give generalized statements thinking that, okay, this is harmless. So generalized statements are to be avoided. Sweeping statements. Rather, क्योंकि आप जवाब स्वीपिंग और जनरलाइज क्यों देते हैं, क्योंकि सवाल भी ऐसे ही होता है जनरलाइज. सो लगता है कि चलो सवाल का जवाब दे दिए. नो, वी हैव टू बी वेरी केयरफुल इन गिविंग अंडरस्टैंडिंग द क्वेश्चन. क्वेश्चंस वेयर मस्ट बी वेरी ट्रिकी. फॉर एग्जांपल, यू नो अ क्वेश्चन दैट समवन बिगिंस विद इज, how do you know this client? How do you know this client? Now this question appears to be very simple, straight, innocent question, harmless question. And some people go overboard narrating the whole story, how this client came to me, etc., etc., etc. Financial crimes happen where the chartered accountants get involved, in most of the cases are with comparatively new clients, and those who get trapped are also comparatively younger chartered accountants. It's very less in number of cases that I have seen that senior members have been in problems. There could be exception, but they that is unfortunate. They would not be party to those cases anyways. But when the fraudsters are on prowl, they look forward to young members of profession who are looking for jobs. And all of us are aware that when young members are looking for jobs, they develop contacts, all kinds of contacts. And when a job comes to a contact, their priority is first to get a job and get the money. So they do not do a fact check about the profile of the client. Sometimes, in unfortunate situations, senior members of profession who are aware about a tricky situation would give it to juniors. Do this. They don't want to be into it. And young members do what? Seniors have given it, so naturally I should not doubt it. All these are against the basic principles of our profession. The detailed narratives in our text on auditing standards take care of all these aspects. Now, if somehow you have dropped your caution in understanding the profile of the client and was involved with that client, for a question, how do you know the client? If you answer that, I got this client through some accountant who came to me with a job or something like that, immediately the question falls on you. How did you accept this client? You did not exercise diligence in accepting a client. You should have checked up. So have you not met the directors? Have you not met the promoters? So all those questions come up then. So you have to be very calculated in your answering to these kind of simple questions also. First, at the first point, no member shall get involved with the client whose profile they have not verified properly. But if somehow, if it has happened, then when you have to address it officially, how you are going to address that issue is very tricky. You have to be very careful about this. Another question that comes up is, you know, how did you do the audit? You know, this is another simple question, general question. How did you do the audit? again, please don't give an answer that would be mistaken or misconstrued, or maybe sometimes, you know, misunderstood by the investigators. Okay, this man has not done the job. Because audit is a very detailed process. If somebody is asking a question, how did you do the audit? By giving an answer, I did the test taking, sir. I did the vouching, sir. These answers are not going to give a good sense to the listener. So you can't put such questions back. What you do is, you have to professionally articulate, sir, audit is a very detailed process. Our audit standards require us to do the risk assessment first. What risk assessment? Risk assessment of materiality of the misstatement. We don't rule out the misstatement in the balance sheets, financial statements. And even if there is any misstatement, are they very material or not? We have to assess first. So we are professionally qualified to do that by examining the accounts. So we undertake a comprehensive exercise. And then to satisfy ourselves, we collect evidences. And then the financial statements prepared by the management is approved by us. And we, if we found something wrong, then we give a report that takes care of that. This is the process of audit. So by giving this answer, we are not giving any opportunity to the investigator to say that, okay, that means you have not checked completely. You have not examined 100%. You would say, sir, if you have, my belief is that the balance sheet that I have attested is correct. 100%. It does not suffer from any material misstatement. When I mean material misstatement defined by the audit standards of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. So if you have anything specific, please ask me this. Then only I will be able to answer this properly. So what I mean to say is that you have to take the investigator to that level where he raises specific questions. Then you would be able to give specific answers. It is possible that specific answers are not handy to you then. So you must be prepared beforehand, because if at all you are summoned by somebody, you would naturally go to the financials and the working papers to gauge what could possibly be the problem. Are there any omissions from my side? And you would naturally contact the client or the accounts team or even the complainant, if any, if you are aware about, to understand what was actually wrong or what actually happened. Then you must make an assessment. Of course, if this is the point, these would be the questions. But please don't mistake. The investigators are very smart. They know a chartered accountant is not an insider. He's an outsider. And his role is limited to attestation of the correctness of the financial statement. So therefore, asking anything beyond it only will have the effect of collecting evidences to implicate others or prosecute others. But he is not limited to that. He needs evidences even to prosecute the main fraudsters. So unless and until he corroborates his case with supporting evidences by naming all and sundry who are involved, be it accountants, chartered accountants, his case would not become strong. Then he wants to do the theory of connivance and complicity and conspiracy and things like that. So, apart from trying to collect evidences to prosecute the fraudsters or the management, he would be putting such questions where your role as an auditor also would be questioned. Therefore, you should be prepared not just to answer about the problems that have happened to the company or the whatever financial scam or crime or fraud happened, but also about every line item that is in your financial statement where you are part of. Every aspect in the balance sheet, every aspect in the profit loss account, every aspect in the cash flow statement, and also every point in the disclosures. Because sometimes the allegation may be about improper disclosures. Now, audit evidences are one areas where when somebody raises a question to you, where is audit evidence, you get sometimes on the back foot. Because it's a very complicated area. What all things do you collect as audit evidences? Are we supposed to keep the backup of the accounts of the audit entity? Are we supposed to keep the bills and vouchers of the audit entity? Are we supposed to keep the other records? There are no such prescriptions. No way. But today's world is very complicated. You need to prove your innocence. It is not that the one who is alleging you has the obligation to put the prove the charge against you. Now things have turned upside. So these days, when the party on the other side is a government agency, unless and until you have got credible evidences to prove your point, they may not bite. But in reality, you may not have all evidences. Receivables and payable in the balance sheet are one big area where questions are raised. Ever since Satyam scam broke out and the institute has taken decision against chartered accountants who are involved with it, on the ground that the audit evidences collected by the auditors were not sufficient because third party confirmations have not been in place. It has become a norm. Third party confirmations have been collected or not. We must remember in Satyam case, third party confirmation was a necessity because the very line item of a huge bank deposit was in dispute. If there is evidence of a material misstatement in the financial statement, and over that material misstatement, if the auditor had not commented, believing that there was no misstatement, and for his belief, the reason was that he had not collected enough evidence, then not collecting a confirmation directly from an independent party, third party, is an offense. It not only puts you professionally negligent, grossly negligent, but also the investigators would take you to other level. That does not mean that whenever you are asked a question by an investigating authority, had you collected the third party confirmation, you should feel guilty. If you had taken a correct call at the time of audit not to collect independent confirmation, because you had confidence that these are correct figures, then you would have that confidence even when you face the investigators. On what basis did you confirm that the balances of receivables and payables were correct without having confirmation? If you had a conviction then why that conviction is destroyed or lost now? It cannot happen. There could be 2-3 situations. One, you were a meticulous auditor where confirmations have been received. No problem. Second, confirmations have not been received, but you were careful to disclose that in the notes and accounts. And therefore, you can say that, sir, I have, this is disclosed. Third, you have neither disclosed nor collected a confirmation. In both the situations that I have described, the last two situations were confirmations have not been received but disclosed, or confirmations have not been received and not disclosed. Your position is not very different. Because after all, the one who is investigating you is trying to find fault with you. So when there is a case that you have not collected a confirmation, regardless of the disclosure or not, he would try to put the blame on you. Therefore, you have to be very careful in answering. So you, rather than saying that I have not collected a confirmation, you would say that, sir, according to my professional judgment, I'm going by the accounting audit standard, SAS 500, I was not required to collect the confirmations here. That was my judgment. So SA 505 was not required to be applied here. That was my call. It's my professional judgment. So whether my professional judgment was incorrect or not is something that can be debated now. To debate that, you have to first demonstrate that any balance that I have certified as correct, payable or receivable for that matter, wrong or not. Because the misstatement is what I am supposed to examine. And I am supposed to report only when there is material misstatement. And I have confirmed myself that all these figures are correct because of other corroborating evidences. The transaction that went into the books of account, the subsequent transaction that validated the transaction, and therefore the possibility of there is no misstatement in the balance sheet was confirmed. So therefore, I had no reasons to go for additional evidence like an independent confirmation. That is the context I did not insist for the independent confirmation. That is the reason I have certified that I have obtained all information necessary for my audit. Because the next question of the investigator is that, why did you then say that I have obtained all information necessary for my audit? And you are reasserting that, yes, sir, what I said is I have obtained all information that is necessary for my audit. So what is necessary for my audit is decided by me. Audit is a matter of professional judgment. Here, if you are smart enough, you can recollect SA 500, application para 5 or 9, etc. But it is very clearly stated. Audit evidence collection is a matter of professional judgment for the auditor. I don't mean to say that don't collect any evidence and simply argue back. No, that's not going to happen. If you have been reasonably careful in your audit, regardless of the fact that some of the evidence have not been there, you can always hark back to the investigator, sir, you are raising this question to get an answer no from me, and then it goes against me. Why should I give evidence against me like that by saying a yes or no on this? I would like to give a detailed answer like this. Here, there have to be a discussion, because you know, no answers are given spontaneously by getting a question. That's not the way it happens. Those who have raised the phase of music investigation know that. The questions are raised orally. Answers are asked from you. They confirm what is that. And when they find that, okay, this answer is okay for me, then they say, okay, fine, write up. So then, when you give answers of this sort, he would say, no, why are you writing all this? Then you would say, sir, this is, you would use this against me as an evidence. And if I write something improper, incomplete, a third person would not understand. What is the context in which I have spoken so many things to you and wrote only two lines on this? So all what I discussed with you, the context of it, is not in the statement. Therefore, I have to write down. Now, what I am explaining here is a confident approach by the members. Taking such an approach before the investigating agencies is not a cakewalk, because they time and again threaten you with their power. It amounts to intimidation. We all know that. But that's the way the world is. Investigators always have the high hand. But you are not required to give evidence against you. That is the law. So when you have got opportunity to give evidence, then you should be careful that evidence doesn't go against you. So in the context of a confirmation, balanced confirmation, your answer has to be that. Why did you not collect the confirmation? Now, unfortunately to you, suppose the investigating agency is then taking out a particular account, balance, and bringing evidence to you that, yes, your call was this, but this is the balance, and this is the balance in the balance sheet. The party is saying that there is nothing like that. This is something different. So that means you have erred in your duty. Again, you are not admitting that you have erred in your duty there. You would say that, sir, I have to examine what was the basis of my certification. I can examine that and come back. If I have erred, I would admit it. If it was a small mistake, I would admit that. If it's a big mistake, I would admit that also. But give me time to examine that. Similar is with the, I was just talking about balanced confirmation. Now, take the case of another thing, the stock, another common point. The problem with the stock is that, if it's a case of NPA and then unsecured, and the bank is not able to invoke the SARFAESI and not able to recover money, then they would next do what? If they are not able to recover the money from the security, and if there is no collateral, then they know that the officers who are involved in the loan is going to be in problem. So they would do what? They would put the blame back to company, alleging some or other kind of fraud. And if you had given some certificate for the purpose of sanctioning of the loan, or during the tenure of the loan, all those certificates can come into question. So a periodical receivable statement, or a stock statement, or a net worth certificate, or a certificate given by you for infusion of additional capital by the promoters, all these certificates can come in question. So if that is the nature of the case, you have to be very careful in giving evidence to the investigators that, okay, this is the basis of this. If you had been careless in collecting evidence you will be in real trouble. So therefore, before going in front of the investigator, ensure that whatever you have done, I'm not talking about audit now, I'm talking about certification, enough evidences have been with you, duly signed by the management of the organization. Stock is one area where, you know, problems happen. A third party, an independent stock auditor might not find stock, but you have signed the balance sheet. Things like that with stock. So if the investigator is equipped with the two reports where a stock auditor says that stocks were not there, but a balance sheet auditor said the stock is there, question would be, where is the stock audit, stock evidence? How did you sign this? What is the audit evidence for this? So first thing they ask is physical verification done by you. If you have not done the physical verification, please don't get taken aback. Okay, I have not done the verification. So don't admit that. Okay, I have not done the physical verification. Sorry. No, that's not the way it is. Physical verification is one of the best methods. Like third-party balance confirmation is the best audit evidence. Higher degree audit evidence. Similarly, conducting physical verification is one of the best ways of ensuring the correctness. But practically, how many auditors have been able to do that? We don't have the wherewithal, the quantity of stock may be too much, the type of item may be too many, the stock may be spread on many places, the storage may be peculiar. So considering all these things, so, you know, physical verification might not have happened in many cases. But if you have an audit documentation suggesting, how did you go about the audit, I mean, evidence collection, then on the basis of that evidence, if you can substantiate to the investigator that, sir, look at this. This is the book stock I have had. And these are the evidence of the correctness of purchases, sales, book stock. And physical verification was done by the management. And this is the report. You may ask this question, then what about your audit standard, SA 500, guidance note on inventory verification, valuation, et cetera, et cetera. Guidance note suggests that. But guidance note, SA 500 talks about audit evidence. You must remember that. Why I'm referring to all this is because, you know, unless and until you are very clear about the principles that guide us in conducting audit, you wouldn't be confident to answer properly. SA 500 gives which all audit procedures. Inspection, which means inquiry, vouching, examination of accounts, etc., etc. Observation, which means observation of physical verification and things like that. Confirmation, recalculations, analytical procedures. So physical verification is an extended part of observation. Ideally, if you go by SA 500, it says that when the management conducts the examination of stock, the auditor should observe it. You are not supposed to be physically verifying everything. But our institute guidance note says that no, you should, if it is possible, you do that. So those, we have to respect those principles and guidances, no doubt about it. But now we are talking about a context where we have to address before the investigator that how did you do it? So this question can be very tricky. How the value was arrived at, how the physical stock was confirmed, etc. So when you go before the investigating agency, go prepared. The context and the background and the manner in which you examine and satisfied yourself. Similarly, other line items of the in the balance sheet. For example, the related party transactions. No, related party transactions would be investigated thoroughly during investigation. Why? Because when there is a financial crime, there is always a possibility that some diversion of funds must have taken place. So when it is a case of siphoning of funds, it must be through some related party. And if it has escaped your examination, then although you may not be party to the siphoning, you would be charged with professional negligence. And the SFIO does not stop there. The SFIO goes one more step. An audit report, they take along with the returns, reports, etc., etc., and invoke 478 section of the Companies Act, which becomes a charge to be adjudicated by a district civil court or a subordinate court, which has an imprisonment as a penalty also. So when it is a normal case of professional, negligence, you would think that, okay, fine, this is okay, I have to address the institute and some disciplinary action would be there. But when it is in the context of a fraud or a misappropriation or a siphoning of funds or another financial crime, the whole angle changes. Then the definition of fraud under Section 477 would be invoked for everything and anything. And 478 clauses would be invoked where, the audit report signed by would be a false statement, false report, culminating to a crime. Therefore, the related party disclosures, if it is deficient, you have to be careful not to admit, oh, I have chosen not to disclose it. Please don't. Janne ke baavadu, the related party ko disclose na kara, bada crime ho gaya. Na jana, to alag baat. To related party ki information collect karna bhi koi choti kaam to hai nahi. Because we have to trust and we have to rely upon the management of the company. But if you can demonstrate to the investigator that, sir, I have tried all my best to do collect the evidences and look at the communications I have had with them, look at the report they have given to me. And then from there, if you say that, okay, all these things that they have reported to me, I mean, identified as parties, I have examined and I have properly reported. Then you have a case to save, protect. But if you have failed to report on RPTs, or if you have failed to collect information on RPTs from the management, then you may not have a strong case to defend before the investigator. So please don't feel helplessness before the investigator. But that being the fact, you should be prepared before going to investigate. You would be surprised sometimes to get information from the investigators that, okay, this is a related party. And in your report, the report that was given by the management, management has not disclosed it as a related party. Then the next angle of investigation begins where, whether the auditor had opportunity and means to find out this as a related party or not. Now, that kind of a question would be raised by the investigator. Aapko to pata hi tha ye bhi to related party hai. नाम से दिखता है, डायरेक्ट काम से दिखता है, एड्रेस से दिखता है, कॉमन ट्रांसैक्शन से दिखता है. He can allude, he can give so many evidences alleging that if you had been vigilant, you would have identified this also as a related party. So you have to then do the postmortem. You should say that I have to examine this, sir. I don't know who are the people behind it. Yes, you may be saying that address is same, or maybe of the company address. But are the people behind this same? If the people are not same, they don't come within the scope of a related party, regardless of the fact that it is a common address. Then he would say that fine. If this is a common address and this is not a related party, but did you suspect the transaction? So your point is that why would I suspect the transaction, sir, if the transactions are genuinely documented and complete in all sense? What is the reason for me to suspect it? At that point of time, I am talking about the intricate details of the deliberations that would take place. You would be encountered on many angles. So therefore, you must be very vigilant and articulate in addressing those points. But the first and foremost point is that, brothers, you should collect evidences of having obtained all information, number one. Ensured correctness, number two, and wherever there are gaps and variances, documentation for your judgment. What was the judgment? On what basis did you take the judgment that this is not reportable, this is reportable? This is not material, this is material. So this is not worth reporting, or this is not worth disclosing, or this particular wrong presentation is not very important. Loans and advances, not just from the related party angle, but also for the CARO and all, because they are not going to limit your investigation with the procedure. There are two, three angles. One is the very process of audit is challenged to prove that you have not discharged the responsibility, even under the Companies Act. Nowadays, section 143 or earlier 227. So that is one angle of looking at. You have not discharged your responsibility. In showing the seriousness or the process, the very processes where, you know, the audit standards have to be complied with, accounting standards have to be complied with, all those matters are there. Law also says that, our institute guidelines also say that, principles also say that. It's there. Second point is they examine from the angle of audit reporting. Even after finding out this, okay, fine, these are these things. But whether this report was sufficient. For example, the problematic section 183, 186. Advances to entities that are reported in the related party transaction, but for the purpose of CARO, you have not said anything. Why a pertinent question about the interest of shareholders or the correctness of interest, etc., etc., or complaints of norms of 185, 186, why have you chosen not to report on that? So, if that point could come, you must speculate, you must pre-guess, yes, this also can come. And your answer must be ready. Complaints was there, so not reported. Rate of interest was appropriate, so not reported. Transactions always are disclosed properly, So there was nothing to report because after all, I was supposed to report only the adverse things. So I did not find anything adverse. Tell me what was adverse in it. You would be able to pose this question back to them only when you are confident what you have done. Similarly, 7376 Companies Act, you know, but public deposit section, banks or debentures or directors may be exempt, but there could be fringe advances coming in, loans coming in. And if they have been careless in presenting that in the balance sheet under unsecured loans or here or there, then questions could come. Why is this not a public deposit? Why it is not a violation? Things like that. Why did you not report? Go prepared well. You would face questions on every line item because they come prepared. They come prepared with the balance sheet. They have been supported by other chartered accountants who are on the panel. So they have got all questions. And please don't mistake that they are questioning only on the crime that happened. No. That they would ask anyway. But they have got 2 points. One is, if the company's financial statements and reports are correct, then how a crime? So a crime has a genesis backward. It traces back to some years. And a crime has been happening for long. It's a planning. They have to prove that. So they have to disturb and they have to challenge and they have to disprove that the balance sheet that is signed in the previous years are wrong. To prove that wrong, they have to call the auditor also on the wrong side of the law. This is the way the investigations take place. So you must be very careful about all these aspects. Balance sheet has the disclosure part to call something. If you want to find fault with something, it's very easy, you know. You try finding fault. So one or two small omissions on the Schedule 3 requirements in the balance sheet, or a small omission on the disclosure part in the face of the balance sheet, be it on loans or other things, liabilities. They can come up. If there are apparent glaring small errors that would not appear to be big material misstatement, be graceful in admitting their result. You said this is a small omission. But immediately after admitting, you should say, correct that, sir, my admission doesn't mean that I have done something professionally wrong because this amounts to a very negligible, non-material mistake, which did not require my qualification. But I admit it could be an oversight. So wherever you have to admit, you know, you have to be careful in not admitting the professional gross negligence or not exercising due diligence. Because it is not just the complicity or connivance or dishonesty behind the as the intent. Even if there is no dishonesty, if you have not been competent in your job or you have not done job honestly or maybe carefully, diligently, then also the sword falls on you. So I was just talking from the balance sheet point of view. Recently there have been exposes of many big scams, GST related scams, where people were building books with false turnovers and things like that. It's unfortunate that some chartered accountants have been prey to those kind of games without understanding, without knowing, without knowledge. But those who have been involved in that have to, you know, if they have, I would like to clarify that. See, look, my point is only to those people who have been truthful in their job and have somehow been trapped in an investigation. If a person has been associated with a crime willfully, he has no place to go. Then he has to face the music. My lecture is not meant for him. So these days, members are not very careful about the legitimacy of the turnover. It's an important point to be remembered. Ever since GST has come up, a lot of wrong practices have started in the market. Particularly, you know, the job work associated with some business. Tracking the movement of the goods associated with job work and documenting them properly and then subjecting them to higher amount of GST, etc., have become burden for many small and medium entities. So what they resort to is they cut sale invoices when they push goods, and they get purchase invoices issued from the other party when they get it back. There are certain industries that have been identified already. As a result, the sales invoices and purchase invoices have become multifold. If the organization, the entity books all those things in the records, sales go up, purchases go up, and a banker mistakes it, and he gives advance on the basis of that, it leads to over-financing. So, regardless of the truth that there are invoices, whether those invoices have commercial substance or not is a question to be checked by the auditors. Unfortunately, young members perhaps don't look at that carefully. Always. And number of investigations happened where, you know, they call it bogus invoice. I call them invoices that have no substance, commercial substance. So for us accountants, to recognize revenue, sales invoices are not the criteria. Because accounting standard 9 does not support recognizing revenue where there is no commercial substance. If the documentation is only facilitation of movement of goods for the purpose of compliance of a law, so be it. You must disclose that these are the invoices for the purpose of GST. This is the amount that we have found at offsetting with the purchases. And this is the only amount of sales that, according to me, is the revenue. So a reader gets the clear understanding. Those members who have not taken that careful step and subjected to investigation these days are facing music, because the investigators say it's a bogus sale, bogus purchase. So, if it has happened, then you have to prove that no, it is not bogus. They are genuinely purchases and sales backed by invoice movement of goods. And if you can demonstrate, then of course, the criminal element of it would go off. There are two elements of it, as I told you. One is the criminality element of 478 or 477. That would go off, because if the documents are there, movement is there, it is, of course, transactions are correct. Presentation also is correct. However, from an AS9 point of view, the institute may not look at kindly. So professional misconduct can be an allegation. So even if there are cases of, you know, booking of, overbooking of sales and purchases, you must examine the cases properly and see that, does it border the breach of violation of 477, 478? Or does it attract that? Or is it a simple case of overlooking the accounting standard 9? I'm not, AS9 overlooking yours is not a simple case. But as compared to the other one, it is simple, because the other one attracts imprisonment. So my friends, I have been trying to give examples of many kinds of things that happen in the market. But of course, there is a limit for me to explain the instances. I told you sometime back, the audit reporting quality also would be subject to test. For example, you have done a beautiful audit And it's a client who's been with you for long. You know that a client does well, and these are aberrations. So I don't have to give a very negative report about him. So you chose to give a qualified report. If you are encountered by a question from a CBI officer or a SEBI officer, SEBI investigator, or from an SFA investigator, why did you limit this to a qualification rather than adverse report? Don't be surprised by these questions. These questions have become common now. We believe that the audit opinion is, after all, a judgment matter for me. And if I have opined it, then nobody should dispute that. But now the judgments are disputed. So if your judgment is disputed, how would you substantiate that my judgment is a genuine judgment, brother? And there is no error in the judgment. We are now getting into a new trajectory. Error of judgment in earlier times used to be pardonable. Error of judgment is error of judgment. But now, things have come into such stage where error of judgment is to be justified now with the evidences. No, it is not an error of judgment. In my view, it is a correct judgment. Because nobody pardons error of judgment also. So when SA 705 says that material misstatement, if not pervasive, then only you can qualify. And if it is pervasive, you have to make adverse report. In your audit report, if you have not made it adverse, to validate and justify that, yes, it was only material mistake, not amounting to perverse, you have to have sufficient audit documentation and validation. As I said in the beginning, it is not about keeping a lot of invoices or vouchers or ledger statement or tally backup. It is about properly made notes on every line item and the conclusions that you have made are based on reasonable judgment. That is what is working paper. That is what is working note. Our SQC 1 expects you to make proper sheet with reference to every audit standard. And then every line item has to be tested from each of those audit standards point of view. And if you have a proper conclusion, then nobody would dispute your judgment. Because you must understand, in an investigation case, the judicial process takes time. However, the disciplinary process is faster. If you can demonstrate to your regulator that you have done your job properly and you can get a green signal, that becomes a big evidence for you to support you before the court when the judicial process takes place. So the first and foremost thing that you have to do is to demonstrate that you have done your job very efficiently and carefully. Now, I have deliberated as much possible for the topic that I could, and I wish members have been receptive to my point. Rajeshji, if people have more questions on that, then I would be glad to answer that. Otherwise, main thoda sa samshipt karne ke liye koshish karunga. Rajeshji?
Abhi sir, thank you very much. Abhi sir, only two questions hai. Two questions are there. Would you like to answer them, sir?
Please, aap puchhe.
Mr. Naveen Kumar is asking, sir, will certain representation letter for for the matter unknown to auditor would be helpful, like in case of related party transaction.
देखिए मैं थोड़ा टच किया हूँ इस सब्जेक्ट को, दोबारा बताता हूँ. रिलेटेड पार्टी ट्रांसैक्शन के लिए मैनेजमेंट से रिप्रेजेंटेशन लेना बिना हमारा कोई काम नहीं चल सकता, क्योंकि हमारे पास इंडिपेंडेंटली रिलेटेड पार्टी के बारे में जानकारी लेना बड़ा डिफिकल्ट है. पर ऑडिट के दौरान जब आप एक संस्था से जुड़ते हो और वो संस्था की और भी एंटिटीज के साथ आप एसोसिएट होते हो, और सर्कमस्टेंशली आपको ये पता चलते है कि एक पर्टिकुलर एंटिटी रिलेटेड पार्टी की दायरे में आ सकता है, पर आपने देखा तो रिपोर्ट के अंदर मैनेजमेंट रिप्रेजेंटेशन में मैनेजमेंट ने नहीं लिखा है, तो आपका फर्ज बनता है कि ये सवाल पूछना है कि ये रिलेटेड पार्टी क्यों नहीं है, और उसके बाद एविडेंस देगा कि रिलेटेड पार्टी नहीं है तो फिर तो अलग बात हो गया. नहीं तो आपके अगेंस्ट में कोई इन्वेस्टिगेटर आरोप लगाता है कि आप जानने के बावजूद भी इस बात को आपने गौर नहीं किया, तो आपके पास एविडेंस होना चाहिए कि नहीं नहीं जानने के बावजूद भी, या ये मैं जान सकता था और जान दिया था, पर मैंने सवाल पूछा और उसके बाद मेरे को जवाब मिला, उसके बाद मैंने छोड़ दिया. तो मैनेजमेंट रिप्रेजेंटेशन से ही रिलेटेड पार्टी की इन्फॉर्मेशन आता है, पर ऐसा नहीं है कि मैनेजमेंट पार्टी रिप्रेजेंटेशन मिलने से आप बिल्कुल आप अपने आंख और कान बंद करके रखेंगे, आपको थोड़ा सा और एग्जामिन करना पड़ता है, इन्वेस्टिगेटिव होना चाहिए.
नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन सुरजीत वालिया जी पूछते हैं
जी,
प्लीज एलोबरेट सेक्शन 212 सबसेक्शन 14 CA 2013 मीनिंग ऑफ डायरेक्टली और इनडायरेक्टली रिलेटेड विद द अफेयर्स ऑफ द कंपनी.
212 तो 1956 की बात कर रहे हैं आप, अभी तो 2013 के लाओ में हम. Is he referring to company
act 212 subsection 14
is he referring
to 2013 company act
acha
2013
now please read that once again, what is the question?
Please elaborate section 212 subsection 14 CA 2013 act meaning of directly or indirectly related party with the affairs of the company.
Ha again he is talking about related party, right? Directly or indirectly related party, see, there have been instances recently that some entities have resorted to inappropriate practices by using entities that have been made in the name of employees and such people. You know, so these organizations are considered by the investigators as indirect related parties in their investigation. But this becomes a very debatable issue, because what the investigators are doing is they are creating reports in such a way that the addresses are same, or the people who are associated with entities are closely linked to the management of the company, although they don't come directly as relatives. So these are indirectly related. So this particular section is abused a little. I wouldn't say abused, but it is interpreted in such a way that it goes against the management. But the point is very simple, sir. See, if somebody has done some mischievous act by using entities, bogus entities through parties, then law's intent is only to cover those things, you know. So in a criminal matter, these would be questioned. But for an auditor, this would not be a problem for him, because for an auditor, he relies upon the management representation. And for him, considering these kind of bogus entities are related parties, there is no possibility. There is no way to do that. Therefore, this, regardless of the fact that 212 subsection 14 covers a wide spectrum of, you know, indirect related parties, that is only to cover the charges in 477 and 479, etc., to my view, not for implicating chartered accountants you know, for professional misconduct.
Next question. Ankush is asking, what is the worst case scenario at the end of ICAI disciplinary committee in case one is stuck in a matter, whether it will be a temporary suspension or cancellation of COP? Very good question, sir.
The law of ICA regulations are simple. If an offense comes under professional misconduct falling in second schedule, he can be removed for life as a member. It is not about COP, please remember. COP or no COP, membership is removed. You would no longer be a chartered accountant. It is not about COP. Please remember that. So, institute has a power to give a permanent removal from a membership also, and the clauses coming under second schedule. And one of the clause I have been referring in this lecture many times, professional gross negligence is a clause that comes in second schedule. So for a, and you should remember, in the case of Satyam, the member has been, two members have been removed for life only under this clause.
Next sir, question. Suresh Bhandari is asking, is there any time limit for asking question when you have given answer in detail in last year to any government agencies?
See, technically, you are not supposed to keep records beyond 8 years. So if you are asked any question beyond 8 years, then you would say that I don't have the records. That's all. So your not answering would not be construed as your non-cooperation or something, because the law doesn't expect anybody to answer after 8 years. That's it. But they would raise questions. That's a different point.
Sir, abhi ek one question came to on my WhatsApp, that one director lodged a complaint against auditor that his signature is not on the balance sheet. What was happened when the balance sheet came after signing by the both the director, auditor put his signature and issued the audit report. But later on, one of the director claimed that his signature is false. Now the police department is behind the auditor.
So, you know, basically, we must remember the law. Board of directors, in a meeting held for the board of directors, approve the balance sheet and the auditor signs it. Now, if the balance sheet was passed in a board meeting by circulation and auditor was not able to ascertain himself that the person who was signed is not the one, then these kind of allegations can always happen, and only point is you have to prove it through forensic examination that signature is genuine. And if the person proves that it is not his signature, then obviously you can file a criminal case against the other director who has signed it, and you can say that he has implicated me. So immediately file a case against the other director who was claimed to be the signatory of the director. That's it.
But sir, for the time being, the CA may be in a big trouble.
No, the CA will not be in trouble, because the moment the CA goes against the other director who has forwarded a balance sheet with the claim that the other director's signature is genuine, that means he has done a criminal offense. So therefore, the institute would spare him.
But sir, all the records like Minaj books or Dil Singh are in the control of the management, and the CA is not in a position to have a copy or recover them from the management.
No. See, if somebody is alleging that the signature is forged, the first question to be examined is, bhai, agar wo forgery ki complaint karte hain, to forgery, matlab directly signature, direct signature ko confirm karne ki aapka koi daayitv tha ya nahi tha. Is case mein to answer to daayitv tha. क्योंकि बैलेंस शीट साइन करने से पहले डायरेक्टर्स की सिग्नेचर को कंफर्म करना आपका रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी बनता है. तो अगर आपने एक आदमी से पूछा, वो कह रहे कि हाँ मीटिंग हो गया था और ये दोनों ने साइन किया हुआ है, तो वो दूसरे की क्लेम करा, तो नेचुरली फिर तो वही आदमी क्रिमिनलाइज हो गया. तो आपको मिनट की या रेजोल्यूशन की जरूरत नहीं होती.
लेकिन सर ये सब तो
ओरली
होता है ना, कि वी आई मेड अ कॉल टू अनदर डायरेक्टर एंड ही कंफर्म दैट वी हैव साइन द बैलेंस शीट. This is all our and oral, not in writing.
But आपके पास तो एक कॉपी है ना, बैलेंस शीट साइन है, उसे लेकर के फॉरेंसिक करा के देखो ना.
अच्छा, फॉरेंसिक ही कराना पड़ेगा, अदरवाइज और कोई वे आउट नहीं है.
नहीं, आपके पास कॉपी तो है उनका साइन बैलेंस शीट, तो फॉरेंसिक करा के देखो और प्रूव करो कि ये बैलेंस शीट मेरे पास आया हुआ है, मैंने थोड़ी साइन किया है, तो मेरा क्या इंटरेस्ट है साइन करने की. तो उसमें तो कोई इम्प्लीकेशन ज्यादा कुछ होगा नहीं, वो झगड़ा आपस में झगड़ा होगा और कुछ नहीं होगा. परेशानी जरूर होती है, ये कोई इतने बड़ी केस नहीं होता.
Next question. Ashok ji is asking, can investing agency like CBI may force a CA to become a government witness?
मैंने ये सवाल तो ये तो जवाब बता दिया देरी से पहले से ही. कोई फोर्सिंग नहीं कर सकता आप पे, आपका चॉइस है. कोई फोर्सिंग नहीं कर सकता आपका चॉइस है.
नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन अशोक जी का अगेन क्वेश्चन है. इफ ए बोरोअर अकाउंट बिकम एनपीए इन बैंक इज ए सीए लायबल एनीवे व्हाइल सबमिटिंग सीए सर्टिफाइड डॉक्यूमेंट टू द बैंक बाय द बोरोअर.
ग्रॉस नेग्लिजेंस आपका प्रूव किया तो आप हो जाता है
लायबल रहेंगे. नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन एंड लास्ट क्वेश्चन. अंकुश जी इज आस्किंग वंस अगेन. नॉर्मली लॉ एजेंसीज लाइक सीबीआई ईडी एटसेट्रा डोंट गिव डिस्चार्ज और गिव क्लीन चिट टू प्रोफेशनल इवन आफ्टर सिग्निफिकेंट टाइम ऑफ सबमिशन ऑफ रिप्लाइज टू देयर नोटिसेस. इन सच सिनेरियो व्हाट शुड द प्रोफेशनल डू वेदर टू परस्यू एजेंसीज टू गिव डिस्चार्ज और क्लीन चिट और ए लॉजिकल एंड टू इंक्वायरी इन राइटिंग.
देखिए इन्वेस्टिगेटिंग एजेंसी के पास ऐसे कोई डिस्चार्ज नोटिस देने की पावर ही नहीं है. दे आर जॉब इज ओनली टू इन्वेस्टिगेट एंड मेक ए चार्ज शीट. सो द क्वेश्चन दैट यू हैव टू आस्क इज दैट यू फाइल अ आरटीआई पिटीशन एंड आस्क वेदर द चार्ज शीट हैज बीन फ्रेम्ड इन दिस पर्टिकुलर केस और नॉट एंड फाइंड आउट चार्ज शीट हैज बीन मेड और नॉट. इफ चार्ज शीट हैज बीन मेड एंड यू हैव नॉट बीन मेड अक्यूज्ड दैट्स ऑल. यू हैव बीन ऑलरेडी एक्विटेड. यू हैव नॉट बीन चार्ज शीटेड दैट्स ऑल. ये तो इनडायरेक्ट कम्युनिकेशन हो गया ना. अगर उनसे पूछना चाहिए कि भाई आपने इसमें चार्जशीट बना दिया कि बना दिया और फाइल कर दिया कि नहीं कर दिया. अगर चार्जशीट बना करके फाइल कर दिया इन्वेस्टिगेशन रिपोर्ट बन गया है जिसके अंदर आप अक्यूज नहीं है तो बात खत्म हो गया.
ठीक है सर. ठीक है नाउ आई थिंक देयर इज नो क्वेश्चन. थैंक यू वेरी मच सर एंड आई रिक्वेस्ट आवर गुरुजी एंड कन्वीनर ऑफ दिस स्टडी सर्कल सुनील धमीजा जी प्लीज काइंडली प्रेजेंट ए फॉर्मल वोट ऑफ थैंक्स सर.
Thanks, Mr. Sajan. Very lucid deliberation on the subject and giving the insight of the entire areas where the auditor could be held negligible and the precautions have to be taken at each stage is really, you have pinpointed very well. I think it is primarily, I could say from your talk, that if the auditor is really alert and cautious in his approach while doing the audit, there are very less chances that he cannot confront with these kind of agencies, even if there is anything wrong happens at a later stage in the organization. I think with this, we are really thankful to you for educating all of us. We are thankful from Pusa Road Study Circle, and really request you to apprise us in future also, keeping in view the further changes, the recent changes in the law, what requires the auditor to be more cautious. Thanks a lot, sir. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Dhamija ji. Thank you, Rajesh ji. Thank you for the opportunity. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.
Okay, bye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, bye.